Right, I'm now recording, so if you could put your mute on, and I will just say mute everybody, but it doesn't always work, so I'm hoping that everybody gets muted. Mute. Okay, right, it's good to be together this morning, and here we are towards the end of May. Can you believe it? It's the end of May, and we've only had a few church services in the building. But thank God we are able to meet this way and to meet online like this. Really grateful to God for allowing that. But we need to pray as well that the Lord will open the way for us to have church services, because I feel it is an essential service. And if we can get some help with the technology, we could possibly put it on in church for those who want to come to church and try and have it on Zoom at the same time. For those that are worried, or maybe older people that don't want to go out, and we could do both. So we'll talk about that again in the future. So right now then, I think it would be good for us to start in prayer. So can we just have a word of prayer now? Our precious Heavenly Father, we want to commit today to you. This is the day that you have made. It is a day that we rejoice in being the first day of the week, that we meet every first day of the week, and we meet to worship you and to praise you and to exalt the name of Jesus. We ask for this to be done throughout our country today, that the name of your Son Jesus, Father, will be exalted and lifted high. May this country be known as Christians. May we be a Christian country. May those Christians in Parliament who claim to be Christians, may they nail their commitment to the wall. May they be seen as Christians. May they not be ashamed of you. We pray in Jesus' name that you will touch our country, that you will send the Holy Spirit, that you'll revive our country. We ask for a revival, Lord, in Jesus' wonderful name. And now we also ask you to be with us during this service, that you will allow us to have the presence of the Holy Spirit, that we will not just be a group of people together studying and looking at your word, but more than that, we want to know that the Holy Spirit is among us in every house and in every person that even listens to this recording afterwards. We pray the presence of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. All right, well, to get started, as usual, I'm going to share my screen and make sure that we have some sound so that you can hear the video of the chorus that we're going to start with today. A nice, lively one that I chose to start with today. And so let's go with it.
Woo, come on. Oh, Jesus, we lift up your name. You are King. Hail Jesus, you're my King.
Hail Jesus, you're my King.
Your light frees me to sing.
Your light frees me to sing.
I will praise you all my days.
I will praise you all my days.
Perfect in all your ways. Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
Yes, you are. Jesus, you're my Lord.
I will obey your word.
I will obey your word.
I want to see your kingdom come.
I want to see your kingdom come.
Not my will, but yours be done.
Not my will, but yours be done.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
You take me into the Lamb.
You take me into the Lamb.
We will conquer in your name.
We will conquer in your name.
And proclaim that Jesus reigns.
And proclaim
Light of Jesus. Hail, hail, Light of Judah.
Hail, hail, Light of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful Come on. You are.
Hail, hail, Light of Judah.
Hail, hail, Light of Judah.
How powerful you are.
How powerful you are.
all my days.
I will praise
every
you
day.
All my days.
Hey, you're perfect in all your ways. Your kingdom come.
Want to see your kingdom come.
Not my will, but yours be done.
Not my will, but yours be done.
Let's bring it down.
Amen, amen. How powerful you are, Lord Jesus. We praise you, Lord. Glory to God. Glory to God. Right, now we're about to start, and what I would like you to look at is that picture on your screen. There are some people that will eventually see this on our website, and they will get the recording, but without a video. But you can open the notes, and on the notes you'll see the picture that I'm talking about. So I always recommend to those who watch it or listen to it afterwards on our website that you always open the notes, because the notes have, apart from the notes, any pictures that I show. Well, let's talk about that picture. You know, if you look at it, you'll see that there is a little stream going through from the left to the right, or from the right to the left, across. But there's no bridge, there's just a culvert. And so obviously it's just a little stream that goes through underneath the road. And if you think about that and you look at the lay of the land, I can actually see no reason why that road could not have been straight. From the financial perspective, I think it would have been cheaper to make it straight. It costs more to make a whole lot of turns like that. It's more road, more tar and everything. So why would it be so crooked? Possibly they intended it to be crooked so that it would slow the traffic down. Who knows what lies ahead? There could be danger. There could be a reason for it to slow the traffic down a bit. And I think that that possibly could be a good reason why it would be so crooked. But as I look at that road, I think to myself, think about the people in this world. And if we consider God's righteousness as being the straightest path, then that represents possibly the lives of almost every person on the face of the planet. In fact, Paul said there are none righteous, not even one. And he said, we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And so really our lives are very much like that. There are in some lives, and maybe in every life, a few twists and turns and a little bit of crookedness here or there that possibly need to be dealt with. And so today I would like to be speaking about the subject of straightened out. And in order to do that, I will be looking at a story in the Bible about a lady. And you might want to look it up in your Bible. It will be on your screen, on the computer screen. So you take your choice as to whether looking it up in your Bible or not. There's the reference, Luke chapter 13, and we'll be reading from verse 10 to verse 16. So let's go ahead and start to read it. On a Sabbath, Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues. And a woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. She was bent over and could not straighten up at all. When Jesus saw her, I'm having some problems with my computer not wanting to go to the next one. When Jesus saw her, he called her forward and said to her, "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." Then he placed his hands on her, and immediately she straightened up and praised God. Indignant because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, a synagogue ruler said to the people, "There are 6 days for work, so come and be healed on those days, not on the Sabbath." The Lord answered him, "You hypocrites, doesn't each of you on a Sabbath untie his ox or donkey from the stall and lead it out to give it water? Then should not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has bound for 18 long years, be set free on the Sabbath day from what bound her?" I put up a picture on the screen for you to see, which is maybe a horrific thought of all those men in that picture behind iron bars, crowded, terrible. And yet to me, it reflects something of the people of this world from a spiritual and moral perspective. I think so many people in the world are actually imprisoned in their moral sense and their spiritual sense. They are behind bars, enslaved by Satan. And I think that picture brings it to light. It makes us aware of the fact that there are so many people in the world that are really have their lives so crooked, so bent, that there's no way of straightening it out. And so let's go on to the points that I wanted to speak about today. This woman that we read about was helplessly bent over. And as I said, she possibly reflects so much of the spiritual state of the world. We read in verse 11, it said, "A woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. She was bent over and could not straighten up at all." No act of will, no medical treatment could have straightened her. I'm sure she tried with all her might to straighten up. And I'm sure that if she could afford it, she took medical treatment, medical advice. Nothing could straighten her out. What could have caused it? Well, I looked on the internet for some of the things that cause a bent over back, and there you see some of them: scoliosis, lordosis, kyphosis, sciatica, and so on and so on. So many of them. My grandfather had one of those, and in his later years, he was bent over, and it wasn't a pretty thing to see. When a person has to walk all the time, bent over and looking at your shoes, in order to see where you're going, every now and again, you've got to lift your head up and look where you're going, otherwise you bump into things. But you can't keep your head up like that. You get a stiff neck. Most of the time, you're looking down at your shoes. So my heart goes out to this woman. But you see, this woman did not have any of those illnesses. The Bible tells us that she had a different cause, crippled by a spirit for 18 years. Satan himself bound that woman up. As that picture I showed you of all those men in prison, so Satan has so many people in this world today bound up in the prison of their bodies, in the prison of their morals, in the prison of their spiritual lives. They are bound up. And as crippled as this woman was, crippled by Satan. Satan never stops. He's always trying to make people spiritually crooked, deformed. She could not straighten up at all. Surely she tried. And people must have tried to help her. I'm sure they would have said to her, "Stand up straight. Sit up straight. Straighten your shoulders." I'm sure people said that to her all the time, particularly her own family. I'm sure they meant well, but she could in no wise straighten up, is what the King James Version says. She could in no wise straighten up. The New King James Version says she could in no way straighten up. The NIV says she could not straighten up at all. So there was her situation. In fact, there was no hope for her at all. You know, it's almost like thinking that we can be righteous by our own efforts. You tell people to try and be good. Don't do this, don't do that. You tell yourself that. You want to be a righteous person, but it's just impossible. It is only by salvation and putting on Christ that we can become righteous. When God looks at us, he sees all the crookedness, but when he looks at us through the blood of Jesus, he sees righteousness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Aren't you so glad that you have made Jesus your Savior? The Bible tells us that they overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And that's what it's all about. We put on Christ. And so when God looks at us through Christ, he sees us as righteous. Wonderful. Blessing upon blessing upon blessing. But now this woman, let's get back to her. Bound by a spirit, 18 long years. It reminds me of another man. In fact, there were two of them, but the Bible speaks in a few of the scriptures by only about one of the two. The one called Legion, the demoniac, the one that is spoken of but as two men by Matthew and one man by Mark and Luke. Now, if Matthew said there were two, I believe there were two. But one was so much so that I think that Mark and Luke only mentioned the one who was really bad. And let's think about that guy for a moment. Those two guys, where did they live? Well, the only place for them was among the tombs. So they lived in a graveyard. They were rejected by society. Society tried to chain them up, but the one was so strong, he broke the chains. And there was no known remedy for their condition. They were like that woman who was bent over. No hope. Absolutely no hope. No hope here on earth. Hell on earth. And hell for all eternity. What a terrible situation to be in. Once again, think of that picture that I showed in the beginning with those men behind those prison bars. Think of spiritual prison bars that are upon the lost of this world. The people who don't know Jesus, they're bound up no matter how good they think they are, no matter how well they try and govern their lives. They have hell on earth and hell for eternity. There's no hope for them. Yet, if you think of those two men, you know that one of the two, the worst one of the two, in fact, had something of an evangelist inside of him. Hidden away in that terrible exterior, that man that walked around naked, breaking the chains, so violent that people could not come anywhere near to him, and inside of him was an evangelist. When he was set free by Jesus, he went through the Decapolis testifying of what Jesus had done for him. In fact, he said to Jesus, I want to follow you. And Jesus said, no, don't follow me. You go and tell people about what God has done for you. And he did that. The Decapolis is 10 cities on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And he went around to all of those cities preaching the word by giving his testimony. Just telling them what Jesus had done for him. And you know, later on, Jesus went back to that area, to the Decapolis. And when he went there, he actually healed a deaf mute, a person who was deaf and could not speak and could not communicate. And Jesus healed that person. And because of that, but I also believe because of that man called Legion, who was so demon-possessed, who went out preaching, and I think he had a lot to do with it. But people flocked to Jesus from that very area. 4,000 men were fed by Jesus by seven loaves and a few fish. But I actually believe that that represented at least 16 to 20,000 people, because, you know, normally the women followed more than the men even. And so with women and children added, maybe 16 or 20,000 people flocked to Jesus. And many of those would have been there, I think, because of that man who was once a demon-possessed person who'd been set free by Jesus. When Jesus sets you free, you will be free indeed. And God has a plan and a purpose for every one of our lives. Isn't it incredible to think that that man, that demon-possessed man inside of him, was an evangelist? Praise God for setting him free. And God can set you free. He can set me free. No matter what your need is, you know that the solution is always going to be the same. You see, as you listen to me today, and some people will be listening on the recording afterwards, it goes on to YouTube. It will also be on our Facebook page, and also on the website. And people will be listening to it, and they will have all sorts of reasons of why they have problems in their lives. You know, some have cancer. There are people who have problems with their sight, and maybe even listening to me today, some of you have problems with your hearing or your sight or your back. So many people have hurt their backs. I think of Ravi Zacharias, who's gone to be with the Lord, and he spoke often about the severe back problems he used to have. He had a number of operations, and they put a rod in his back, and he praised the Lord for the fact that he could continue his ministry. But at the end, it was his back where that cancer started again, and the Lord took him. And he had many years of productive ministry because God enabled him in spite of having a sore back. So some of you might have a sore back, and some of you might have a heart problem or blood pressure or cholesterol. Whatever it is, the solution is always come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. On the other hand, there could be those who are absolutely in trouble with, I just want to go back one moment. Get that off the screen. I just want to go back there because, you see, I want to also mention finances. There are people today that are in financial trouble. Businesses have closed down. Many people have lost their jobs or had their salaries reduced. And who knows, but there might be people in deep financial problems right now listening to this sometime today or in the future. And I want to say to you that the solution is exactly the same. Always come to Jesus with that solution. There are people who have family problems. We hear about people abused by family members because of violence coming about, because people are so locked up in their homes that they are becoming disillusioned, they're becoming bored, and abuse starts in the home against the spouse or against the children. And for them too, I say to you, if you are abused, you need to do the same thing. Come to Jesus. That's where we can find solace and we can find reason and wisdom of how to act. Then there are people with addictions. Maybe somebody's listening to me today or in the future, and you are stuck with pornography, that terrible disease that so many people have today, and they hide it away, but they see it on their computers. They see it in the secret places when they turn on their cell phone. You know exactly who you are, and you know that you look at that stuff and you shouldn't, and you feel guilty about it. And I want to tell you, that's what you need to do with it. Come to Jesus. He will set you free. There are others that have addictions of lust, looking at the people of the opposite sex and lusting after them. Covetousness. How many people have looked at others and you see a person getting a new this or new that, a new car, new house, new sewing machine, whatever it is, new clothes, and you covet what they've got. And what about lies? There are people that don't know how to tell the truth. You want to tell the truth, but somehow or other, you always find yourself embellishing, exaggerating, and that's lies. And we do that without even thinking of it, some people. There are others that can't help themselves but scandaling. They find a negative in everybody. They're always scandaling about somebody. When they talk to you, they'll say, do you know what so-and-so do? You know, I don't want to tell anybody else. I'm only telling you. But they go on and they tell everybody. And they tell everybody that they're only telling that person. Scandalers. And they are out of the will of God. One of the worst that I've known for a long time is gambling. We had a man in our church once. He had enough spiritual testimony to eventually become the superintendent of our Sunday school. But he had a gambling problem. And this man could not go past the gambling dens, go past the casino. And we asked him, why do you go in there? Surely your car doesn't force you to go in. You could just drive past. You know, we don't understand how addictions work. People who are addicted to drugs and alcohol and gambling, they can't help themselves. They go there because that's what they have inside of them. But the solution is always the same. Come, Jesus. Beloved, come to Jesus for whatever problem you have, and you will find that he will take you through it. He will help you. My second point today is an invitation was received by this woman, and it was willingly received. Now, that's a very important statement that I put up there as the second point of my talk today. Where was this woman? Well, she was in synagogue on the Sabbath. Now, isn't that where a good Jew is supposed to be on the Sabbath? Isn't that where Christians are supposed to be on the first day of the week, in the Lord's Day, to be in church? Isn't that where you are right now? You see, every one of you have taken the trouble of logging on to the service. And in a way, we are in a church service today. We are where we should be on the first day of the work week. And that woman was where she should have been. And because she was where she should have been, she met Jesus that day, the right place at the right time to receive her healing. She also had a willing spirit. Jesus called her and she came. For 2,000 years, Jesus has been calling. He doesn't come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. You see, the righteous are in a position of pride, in a position where they think they can make it on their own. They are as capable of making it on their own as the people who built the Tower of Babel got right up to heaven. Did they get to heaven? No. God came along and dispersed them because no man can get there on his own. And so the righteous are in a problem area. The self-righteous is what I'm talking about. They're not the ones that Jesus is able to get through. They know they can make it on their own, and they're headed for destruction. But Jesus comes to call sinners, people who are humble enough to come before him and say, Lord, I can't make it on my own. My road is as crooked as that road we saw in the beginning. There are areas of my life, Lord, I need you. And when sinners come to repentance, Jesus is there for you. The church has always been a witness to the power of God. Praise God. Jesus is the one. He is the one. And we need to come to him for whatever we have as a need. Can you imagine that blind man, blind Bartimaeus, when Jesus came along to Jericho? If by some chance Bartimaeus had run away from Jericho, he would not have met Jesus. Where was Bartimaeus? In the right place, at the right time, with the right attitude. He was the one who shouted out to Jesus, Lord Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Beloved, no matter where you are hearing this, know this fact. Know for sure that Jesus is available to meet your need today. Yes, today. Not only tomorrow or the next day, he'll be here then as well. He'll be with you until the end, but Jesus is here today to meet your need. You're in the right place at the right time, so trust him. Put your trust in him. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed. That's what Jesus came to do. Set the prisoners free. Give sight to those who are spiritually blind and even those who are physically blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Then Jesus rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. Oh, beloved, no matter where you are, when you hear these words and you hear this recording, are your eyes fastened on Jesus? That's where they need to be, focused on Jesus. For whatever need you might have, whatever inadequacy you have, Don't get into a spirit of depression. Put your eyes on Jesus. And he began by saying to them, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. And I want to say to you today, today is the day the Lord has made. Today is the day that he can meet your need, no matter what that need is. And so, dear believers, excuse me while I have a drink of water. Sorry about that. Today, fellow believers, let's fasten our eyes on Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. My third point. He was touched, she was touched by the Savior. We've been reading in Luke chapter 13, and in the 13th verse it says, then he put his hands on her, and immediately she straightened up and praised God. In James it tells us, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is anyone merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call on for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. Now that's what I did yesterday for our brother Chris in hospital. I anointed him with oil. We're in a situation right now where we can't always do that. But you know, you can pray, and we can pray for you. The elders will pray. We will pray. Get your name, if you have a problem, on that prayer chain, and we will pray for you. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick. That's what James tells us. The Lord shall raise him up, and her, and if he or her have committed sins, they shall be forgiven. So the elders can't physically do that today, but Jesus today will lay his hands on you personally. I believe that with all my heart. And so call upon Jesus today, and he will answer you, and he will touch you, and he will heal you, and he will set you free if you're bound up by some habit or some addiction that you need to be free of. The solution is Jesus. He will do it for you. Remember the woman who touched the hem of his garment. She was healed instantly. So whether Jesus touches you or you touch him, the result is the same. There's healing. There's healing in Jesus. Healing for the body. Healing for the soul. Spiritual healing. Jesus is the solution. He came and he made that bent woman straight. And he's ready to do that for you and for me. Straighten out our crooked lives. That's what he's ready to do. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 5 says that from Jesus, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of this earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Now just watch what he has done for us. And he has made us kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Oh, beloved, if you know Jesus as your Savior, then you have been made a king and a priest unto his God and Father. We are kings and priests. Hallelujah. That's why you can come fearlessly into the very presence of God, into the Holy of Holies, and have him touch you. That's what he wants you to do today. I want to conclude. Luke chapter 13 and verse 13. Let's look at it again. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. That's the important part. That's our part in it. You see, Jesus healed her. Jesus laid his hands upon her. Jesus called her. Her part was, first of all, to respond and to come to him. Secondly, to glorify God, to be thankful for what he has done for us in our lives. Isn't that what we should all be doing today and every day? This woman was bound and bowed by Satan for 18 long years, and she was straightened out, and she was set free because he came to set the captives free. That's what Jesus did. You see, Psalm 40 verse 2 tells us that he also brought me up out of a terrible, horrible pit, out of the miry clay. He set my feet on a rock and established my steps. He has put a new song in my mouth, praise to our God. Many will see it and fear and will trust in the Lord. And as we trust the Lord, so we can come before him with thanksgiving in our hearts and praise on our tongues for all that he has done for us and all he will still do. If anything I've said today has rung a bell and you've come to Jesus with an addiction, you've come to Jesus with a sickness, you've come to Jesus with a deep financial need, whatever you need, you come to Jesus, you will be able to trust him and praise him and thank him today. And so let me bring this to a close. This last Thursday was Ascension Day. I don't know if you were aware of it. Some of you will be, some won't. So what is Ascension Day? It's the day that we commemorate when Jesus went up into the clouds to go to heaven. He went up in the sight of his disciples, up into heaven. And as his disciples were looking up at him, going up in the clouds, two men appeared, but they were angels. And they said, "What are you guys looking at the clouds for? Don't you know that this same Jesus, as you see him going up into the clouds, will come back in exactly the same way to fetch you? He's coming to fetch us. Beloved, are you ready for Jesus to come and fetch you? Because Jesus is coming. And Ascension Day is one of those highlights that I remember that Jesus went and Jesus will come back in the same way to fetch me. But you know, before Jesus left the earth, he told his disciples to do two things. And he said, "I want you to do these two things. First of all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me." He's telling them that because he's saying, "I'm not giving you a choice now. This thing that I'm going to say now is what I want you to do." He said, "I want you to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And always I'm with you. I will be with you always to the very end of the age." What does Jesus say? He wants us to make disciples. That's the one thing. Everything else is contained in that statement. Making disciples is baptizing them. Making disciples is teaching them to obey Jesus. Making disciples is knowing that Jesus will be with us to the very end of the age. That's what he told us to do. Make disciples. That's the one thing. The second thing he said is, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Jesus baptizes people with the Holy Spirit. You see, those people were waiting. Those 120 were waiting for the gift of the Father. And the Father wants to pour out that gift, I believe, upon South Africa now. We've all been praying. So many Christians in South Africa are praying for revival. God wants to give us revival, and I believe the Father is about to pour out the gift of the promise of the Father. Now listen, friends, I mentioned the Thursday, Ascension Day. What does Ascension Day mean? In 10 days' time, that means next Sunday is Pentecost Sunday. We will trust God to give us another Pentecost, if not before Pentecost Sunday or on Pentecost Sunday, then soon after it. But we need to be praying during these 10 days or the 7 days remaining, 8 days including today. Pray for the gift of the Holy Spirit to come upon the whole church. Pray for the gift of the Holy Spirit to come onto every believer in Calvary Assembly. Pray for the Holy Spirit to come upon you and your family. Beloved, that's what God wants to do. And I want to say that I think that God is ready to do that in South Africa. And so I want to just pray and ask the Lord to do something special among us today. Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus, a name which, not that you would want to, but even you would not be able to resist that name. Of course, you don't want to resist that name, because he's your son and you gave him to us. But that name is so powerful that it moves heaven and earth. And as we pray to you now, Lord, we believe in the words of Spurgeon that we move the hands of omnipotence. And I ask you today to move the hand of omnipotence upon the congregation that listened to my prayer today and this little talk today. May the Holy Spirit come upon each and every one of us in a mighty way. Pour out your Spirit upon us. Lord, fill me again with your Holy Spirit. Fill my family with the Holy Spirit. I pray for my whole family that each and every one of them will be saved. My children, my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren. And I pray that for every member of Calvary Assembly and, in fact, for every Christian in South Africa. Lord, save our families and pour out your Spirit, Lord, that we may be truly born again, filled with the Spirit. And as Jesus said, out of you will come streams of living water. Oh God, we hunger and thirst for that. Streams of living water flowing out of each and every one of us. And to that I say, amen. Amen. Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine, with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness.
Bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and bless you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen.